We're down to the end of absolute truth tonight. Tonight's going to be, I think, a short night. So I'll just tell you a personal story. Yeah?
I observed on the way coming here.
What'd you observe?
The more we are getting away from Christianity, the more pagan they are getting. It's the first time on the way here. I saw in three places there are bonfires in front of the houses. I've never seen that before.
Is that legal?
No, but
I don't think that's legal in Phoenix, is it? No.
But they're imitating the Druids, the Druids,
yeah.
I've never seen that before.
Yeah, I haven't either.
I told Ivan over here, I said, gee, look at this. How they're deviating from it with their bonfires. I've never seen that before.
Now, what neighborhood is that in, by the way?
I was up on 44th Street and Thomas, west of 44th Street.
All right, everybody stay away from 44th Street and Thomas tonight. That place is going down. Wow, I don't think that's legal. You're not allowed to have bonfire. Back in Kansas, where I'm from, you can burn anything anywhere. Years ago, I moved out here. I just gotten out of graduate school. I moved out here in 1980. And I had a bilateral inguinal hernia. Boom! Both of them. Both sides. Boop. Anybody here ever had a inguinal hernia? One guy in the back. Chuck just had one. Yeah.
My grandfather had one.
Yeah, there's three lucky people here tonight. So I go to the doctor. Guess what his name was? I'm not making this up. Zipser. Zipster. Okay. Yep. That was his name. I am not joking. I knew I was in bad trouble. Well, I go to Dr. Zipser and he sews these things up. This one on the right gets infected. And I got pus pouring out of this hole. Pus pouring. So I'm off a full 2 weeks of work with my infection. And heals up, doing fine. Uh-oh, 2008, boop, the right side blows out again. What? Two hernias? That's why they call me lucky. So I go to Dr. Lipton. Decided to switch over from zipping to drinking tea. So Dr. Lipton sews this thing up in 2008, and this time I get a synthetic mesh put in there. And they said they put this mesh in to help people with groin issues so that these things, I guess women get them with their bladder surgery and different things, meshing everything up. And you put your mesh in, then that makes everything great. Well, that was in 2008. About 3 years ago, one morning I got up and I had an odd pain in my adductor muscle here that runs up the inside of your leg, clear up to the where it ties into the pelvis, way behind your genitals. And don't worry about this, that we're human sexuality seminar next month. This is mild compared to that. No kids allowed at that seminar, just adults, please. A little R-rated on that one. So I got this strange pain, and I'm thinking, I don't think anything of it. Hey, I must have pulled a muscle in the gym, no big deal. So, to make a long, boring story short, this thing keeps, I can't get rid of it. Then I go through some therapy, I go through electrical stuff, I go through stretching, hot and cold, exercising, different machines at the gym, trying to get rid of this thing, thinking, hey, this is just a muscle pull, I can whip this thing. And it keeps getting worse. Then it starts going down my leg. Then later on, it jumps over to the other side. Then it starts up here and goes down that leg. I'm thinking, now, wait a minute, now, this doesn't seem like a groin pull because I know I didn't do anything to pull this side. I'm sure of that. I've been watching myself. This is weird. Okay? Want to make an embarrassing story shorter. This one here then decides to expand and it starts to move across the side of my body. It then goes around to my buttocks. Then a month ago, it starts going down my leg. So, plus, this is 3 years now, by the way. I've been going through it for 3 years. Plus, the pain is killing me. It feels like somebody is picking up a knife, ice pick, and going, phew, ah! I mean, I'm having screaming pain. So, naturally, what do? Called my ex-wife, of course, don't you all. Called my ex-wife, she's a nurse, one of my ex-wives, I got them on a Rolodex. I call her, said, listen, here's what happened to me. I got this weird thing going on here, this to that to this, to expanding to growing, now going around, weird, 3 years, can't get rid of it. She says, well, that sounds like you're allergic to mesh. Because they've had a recall on some of these meshes. She was telling me that. I had a memory of watching a couple of ambulance chasers on TV during the day looking for women that had meshes. So I go, well, my God, this mesh thing. I run back to my hernia doctor. I said, I need a copy of my medical records. He gives me the copy, it's short, you know, 10 pages or something. So I'm fumbling through and I found the mesh thing. It was proline ethical mesh, some weird name, you know. So what do I do next? Call the ex-wife again. I say, hey, here's the mesh. Here's the name of it. I got it right here in the report. Ethical proline mesh. That's what it is. Calls me back. Hey, there's been all kinds of people complaining about that mesh. And she said, I think there's something wrong with it. You better have that stuff taken out. So she says, go to the FDA website. So I go to the website. And there was a few years ago a partial recall on that mesh. Some kind of recall on it. So I thought, well, this can't be good. Well, in the meantime, I've done everything I can to get rid of my groin issues. And don't we all? We're all trying to get rid of our groin issues. These are different issues. And I'm thinking, hey, maybe this thing's demonic. So I try doing deliverance and all that doesn't work. I said, maybe I need a healing. I anoint myself. I do all these different things. Not healed. So I said, hey, this sounds like I got a bad batch of mesh in my... I knew it. I should have gone back to Zipser. See, that's what you get. So I says, I'm going to go check this out with some doctors. So I go to four doctors, and they all tell me the same thing. That's strange. That was the exact quote of two of them. That's strange. What's wrong with me? I don't know. Never heard of that before. I said, well, I'm not going to go to any more doctors. I'm going to get this thing taken out of here. This, whatever they put in there, to me, this does not sound good anymore. And I'm going to get this thing taken out. So I go to my fifth doctor 2 days ago. I say, hey, he's a youngster. They're not going to tell you no. Why? Got a yacht payment or something going on there. So I say to the doctor, I said, I know I'm going to get it. I said, Doc, here's my story. So I give him a short version like I gave you, a little shorter. I go, I want this thing taken out of here. I want it out. I've self-diagnosed. And I said, do you have any idea what's wrong with me? He says, I don't know what's wrong with you. But he said, I had another patient who had a mesh, a belly button hernia. How many of you ever had a belly button hernia? I'm the only one. Yes. 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 Hi. Oh, thanks for ruining my evening. Great. Can't wait to see him again. So he goes, this guy had a belly button surgery, hernia, umbilical, I guess they call it, and they put that mesh in there. And I says to the doc, look at this report right here. It says this mesh. Oh, he says, I use that mesh all the time. I didn't say anything. He says, and come to find out that the guy was having a reaction to that mesh in his belly button, he says. So, I don't know what your problem is, but I'll go ahead and take it out for you. I said, good. When's your next surgery opening? You happen to have one this afternoon? No, I don't have any this afternoon. You'll have to talk to the lady over here. So I run down the hall. Boop, I'm going in Monday morning to pull this stuff out. And while you're eating at McDonald's, 7 o'clock, I will be unmeshing myself. And I appreciate your prayers. Now, after hearing that story, does anybody have an alternative diagnosis? You're staying for the deliverance, aren't you? Did you hear that?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, thank you. I don't want to get involved with a bunch of attorneys. I got enough problems right now. And come on. So that's my mesh story. What do you think of it? Nothing. Yeah, I don't blame you. Here it is, Monday through Friday, you and me every morning. Okay, thank you for your donations. Love you. Thanks for supporting us. All the bills are paid. Gracias. Okay, by the way, we're going to be starting on November 3rd, every morning at 10 o'clock in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Monday through Friday at 10 a.m. We'll be on the radio there. We're going to expand there and a couple other places coming up. All right. Now, tonight we're going to go over the absolute truths of God's Word. These are the truths you have to have in order to have a full gospel ministry. If you don't understand these basic truths, you're going to be in big trouble later and your ministry is going to stall out somewhere. Okay? And these were our 1 through 4. We've already gone over these a few weeks ago. Do you remember these? Okay. God is love. God loves humans better than anything. He loved you even when you were your enemy. Then we went through absolute truths 5 through 9. Remember these? We went over sin, God's holiness, the breach of sin, the only way to remove sin, and why religion does not work, why other deities do not work, why nothing else works in the universe. You cannot get rid of your sin any other way other than the blood of Jesus Christ. So you can't pray to anybody else or hope for anybody else or do anything else. Nothing else works for God because there's no way to get rid of sin. And sin is the main problem. Sinning is a major problem. All right, and we went over human free will and how that relates to everything. Sinning, salvation, healing, deliverance. Went through all that. Then we went through truth number 10 through 14. We went over how the spirit world operates. God uses the Holy Spirit. Satan uses demons. And why? We went through omniscience and omnipotence and omnipresence. We went through the concept of actually being born again and the difference between being spiritually born again and being born again in your mind only. There's a big difference. And we went over sacrifices. You cannot get a ministry like a cakewalk. One of the happiest days of my life was when I was in seventh grade. We were poor white folks. And sixth grade, excuse me. I lived right near the grade school, and they were having a big open house and all kinds of different things going on at the grade school that night. And one of the things they were having was a cakewalk. And I'd never won anything in my life. So I had gotten into the line and got into the cakewalk. And so they played the music, and you walk on these numbers. You ever gone on a cakewalk? Ever heard of a cakewalk? Nobody has? Oh, you heard of a cakewalk. Well, what you do, everybody gets in line around, and they circle around, and you stop, and you're on the number, and they call out a number. It was mine. Couldn't believe how happy I was. Scooped up this big old cake, ran across the street and gave it to my mom. So happy. To this day, says a senior citizen, still remember being able to give my mother a cake that I won on a cakewalk. Well, that's quite a bit different than this. Being in the ministry is not a cakewalk. You don't just casually walk around these things and suddenly, boop, God pulls a number and you pull out a number. Oh, I'm in the ministry now. Everything's going to go my way. This is going to be smooth sailing. That's not going to happen. It requires you to make sacrifices, dedication, tribulation, overcoming, pushing your way in. And that's why so few people have a Holy Ghost ministry. They're rare as hen's teeth. Very few people have a Holy Ghost ministry. They're very rare. Why? They require a sacrifice. You have to give up stuff. You have to make changes. You have to get rid of some people in your life. Maybe you will have to stop doing something here and there. Something, anything. There it is. That's the anointing. Remember, I'm not talking about your salvation. It's a different subject. I'm talking about your Holy Ghost ministry. You want to get in the ministry. You want to have the moving of the Spirit. You want to have something from God. Maybe you want to see people healed or delivered or whatever it is, whatever you're called to do. Somebody's going to have to make a sacrifice. And that somebody is y'all. You've got to do it. Okay? We went over the difference between Christians and disciples. Remember that? Everybody? Every disciple is a Christian, but very, very few Christians are disciples. They're very rare. Rare as hen's teeth. Sowing and reaping. Went over that law. Applies to everybody, sinners or saints. And number 15 through 20, wrapping it up tonight, we got through to 18. The parable of the sower illustrates how the gospel works. If you don't become an expert on that parable, you're going to be very confused. You're going to have a very confusing ministry, and things are not going to make sense. That makes sense to you, because people are going to let you down, they're going to betray you, they're going to walk out on you. Some people are going to stick and amount to something great, and you weren't expecting it. And other people you thought were slam dunks to go on to great things for God end up collapsing in a heap as a gasping failure. And you got to, if you don't understand how that works, you're going to get very confused in the ministry. You're going to get frustrated. People are going to frustrate you. I've been a counselor for 33 years. I'm an expert on people. Rodney Dangerfield was right. People are nuts. And the only way you can work with them is to acquire the patience of Job. Did anybody here think I'm joking? You don't, because you have family members. Your family members are whacked, and they're hard to work with. And people, every family's like that. Everybody, man, people are hard to work with. And if you look at the ministry of Christ, man, he had the perfect ministry. The most highest anointing of anybody. He had the most incredible fruit, probably of anybody ever. And everybody abandoned him and they murdered him. Okay? So you got to have the parable of the sower right here in your back pocket. You must know it backwards and forward. You must understand here, 16 was crucial. That's a big controversy. Some people think God doesn't want to help some people and does want to help some others, wants to heal these and don't want to heal those, wants to save these people, wants these people to burn in hell. That's all a spiritual crock. That is not true. If you know a born-again Christian and they're not healed, something's blocking it. There's something involved there that's blocking things, okay? For example, my mesh thing. I tried to cast demons out of me, and it wasn't demons, it was mesh, see? So I asked for a healing, you know, heal my body. Well, I got mesh, see? So if somebody's not healed, your job as a minister, you got to look for the root of it. You don't just give up on them and say, well, they can't be healed. God doesn't like them. That's a crock. He likes them and loves them just as much as he does the person that got healed. Okay, so you have to find the root of it or the blocker, healing blockers. We have a whole seminar on that. Okay? And if you reject all these things God has offered human beings, what comes next? Inescapable judgment. Everybody faces judgment. Christians face the judgment seat of Christ. Sinners face the white throne judgment. But nobody skates. See, it's not a cakewalk, and it's not a skate. Not going to happen. You're going to face judgment. Okay, how'd that go? Those were the absolute truths you need to know. Again, this is the ABCs, the basics of Christianity. We're not getting into super deep stuff. I'm not going to reveal to you who the Antichrist is. I talked to him yesterday, but I'm not going to tell you about it. Why are they laughing? So that's where we are, part five. Okay, this is basic, hardcore, straightforward, nuts and bolts Christianity, period. This is what it is. We'll get back to the glamour stuff next week. Assuming I can, I'm unmeshed. Number 18. Here is a shocking truth that most churches, 99% of them, either don't believe and never teach. Okay? There's a false doctrine all over the place that just because you're born again, you instantly go in the rapture. That's the teaching. As soon as you're saved, if you're born again, you automatically, unequivocally, unreservedly go in the rapture. That is not true. That is a major demonic lie. What are the other two big ones? Christians can't have demons. That's huge. That's one of Satan's biggest, most monstrous lies. And the other one is, I don't exist. And as a result of that, we have tonight, the second biggest holiday in the history of America is Halloween, number two holiday behind Christmas in revenue. This is the big one, second biggest one. And the only reason that it exists is because the lie was believed. Everybody believes it. He doesn't even exist. So there's no way you as a father would put a fourth grader in a devil costume and send him around to pick up candy if you truly believed, Satan actually existed. You wouldn't do that, okay? You believe that Jeffrey Dahmer existed, but you'd never dress your kid up like Jeffrey Dahmer. I don't even know if he has kids. I'm just pointing to a body here. You would never dress your kids up like John Wayne Gacy because you knew him. You know he exists. He absolutely 100% believes, without a doubt or a question, John Wayne Gacy was a human being in Chicago and who murdered 33 people and buried him under his crawl space. That is an absolute fact that is fully documented. He used to dress like clowns to attract kids. Well, the devil does the exact same thing. I don't exist. And because of that truth that he's promulgated on everybody, we have Halloween. Nobody that really believes he exists would ever celebrate him under any circumstances. No one would do that. Would they? No one would. I mean, you'd be petrified. You'd be going, what? I'm not having anything to do with him. We don't have Jeffrey Dahmer holidays in Phoenix where we all go get chicken hearts and eat them and pretend they're our neighbors. We don't do that, do we? Why? Because Jeffrey Dahmer was a real person. He really ate people, and that's disgusting, and I don't want to have anything to do with Jeffrey Dahmer. Right, preacher? But because Satan doesn't exist in the minds of 99% of the people, in fact, the churches today, if you've read any of those Barna studies, there's a huge percent of Christians that go to church that do not believe he actually exists. Have you read those surveys? Yeah, I've done radio shows on them. Christians don't even believe he exists. Can you believe that? Imagine that. That's beyond comprehension. It's beyond pitiful to be able to read God's word and come to the conclusion there is a God, but there isn't a devil. How could that is the epitome of deception and foolish spiritual foolishness. It doesn't get it pretty much any dumber than that. It's dumb and dumber. And this doctrine here is one of his big lies. Not that big, but I mean it's close right to the top here. This one is huge. If you're automatically saved, you go in the rapture. Mark chapter 13, Jesus said, the day no man knows. Angels don't know it, Son doesn't know, only the Father. So, he says, since no one knows, what should you be doing? He's talking to Christians. He's talking to the disciples at this time in this text. You better take heed, born again Christian. You better watch and you better pray, because you don't know. You will never know. What is that? What is he saying there? What's he really saying? You're a born-again Christian, and if you don't watch and pray, you can get caught. Isn't he? Okay, either that or it's a joke. Okay, I don't read the text as a joke. He's telling them an absolute fact. It's a warning to Christians, not sinners. Mark 13, the Son of Man's like a man going for a long journey, and he gave authority to his servants, not sinners, you. And he gave you your work to do. Man, God always gives you authority to do any job he's given you. He never gives you a job that you and he can't handle. Translation, through your own faith, you realize you're never in over your head with the Holy Ghost. He never asks you to do something he knows you, in a million years you couldn't do. Never. So each person gets their own specific work. See? Your work's not the preacher's work. Yours is not hers. Yours not, but you have your own individual work because the Holy Ghost only works with individuals. You have a work and a call, you. However, Christians, you better watch it. Now, why would he tell Christians to watch it if there wasn't anything to watch? Translation, there's something to watch. You better watch out. The porter doesn't know when he's coming. Could be at different times of the night. Could be during the day. But he may come suddenly and find you, born-again Christian, sleeping. Sleeping. I told you last week I just saw a movie on the rapture with Nicolas Cage in it. Cage or Gage? Doesn't matter. I don't like that guy at all. I don't like him at all. You know, I don't like that guy at all. Okay. There's a lot of actors I like. Him, there's something creepy about that guy. He gives me a creep or two. But I watched it because of the subject matter. And the whole thing was ridiculous. So the rapture hits while they're in a plane. And the whole world is traumatized over it. That's not going to happen. Most born-again Christians are going to miss the rapture. And they're going to be sleeping at the time it hits. I'm telling all you Christians, you better watch. Jews had how many watches? I don't mean watches that you wear. I mean watches in the night. Hello. Four of them, thank you. How many the Romans have? Three is correct. Okay, so you need to know, if you got a guarding assignment, from the Sanhedrin, you'd be doing what? How many watches could you be assigned to? Four. There's your Jews. If the emperor gave a watch or a centurion, you would be only one of three watches, so you need to know who the heck's watching. All right? So, take heed, Luke 21, lest that any, he's talking to Christians here, lest any time your heart be barnuo, overburdened with the cares of this life. God, it's so tough to make it through. There's so much stuff to look at and read and pay for and go to and see and buy. And oh, God, I'm so worn out. I got kids. I got grandkids. I'm worn. Oh, there's heaviness on me all the time. Watch out. Watch it. Watch yourself. So that you do not what? What happened? What do people do when they're overburdened? They self-medicate. So Jesus, knowing people better than I ever could, says, listen, if you get overburdened with all the crap in your life, you're going to self-medicate. I know you're going to do it because that's the only way you can get instant relief. So you got to get drunk. You need some drugs. You need an orgasm. You need food. You need a pizza. You're going to overeat. You're going to oversex. You're going to overdrink. Jesus, anybody seeing this? It looks clear to me. Maybe it isn't clear. People by nature, when they get overburdened or stressed out, they will seek some kind of relief or release. And the usual, the self-medication is what hits. So he's saying here, you don't get drunk and have hangovers because you're overburdened, or you're methe, where we get our English word methamphetamine is correct. Methe means drunkenness in Greek. That's where we get the short version of meth. But I sometimes corrugate these things for you folks. I'll just act it out sometimes. It's okay. It's an added benefit. It's just something thrown in. It's a plus. Don't even worry about it. The cares of what? Biotikos. What you do with your life, your career, your retirement, the pressure, money, saving, buying, paying. Oh, God, I got to do all this stuff. Biotikos. There it is. What you do with your life, where you work, your career, what? So overburdened with, got to make some more money, got to pay the bills, got to pay the credit card, push it out. The kids want this, the kids want that, then they want everything. As soon as you start giving your kids this or that, what do they want next? Everything. Do not give your kids everything. They will turn on you later. They will stab you in the back. They will just disrespect you and dishonor you. Do not give your kids everything. Do not spoil your kids. They will turn on you. You will regret it. There it is. So that day comes on who? Christians, unaware. For as a pegis, a hidden trap you don't see, like a trap door. Boop. A snare, it comes to all that dwell on the earth. Watch, therefore, Luke 21, and always pray that you may what? Katataxiao. You will be deemed deserving to go. What? This is the most shocking scripture known to man, practically. God's telling you that you have to be deserving to go in the rapture. By doing what? Being a good person and wonderful and sinless? No. By doing your work he gave you to do. He gave you your job, your calling. You're supposed to be doing something for God, and you're not doing it. Boop, the trumpet goes off, and you don't hear it. You will not hear it. I don't think anybody's listening to me. You must be deemed to be deserved worthy of going in the rapture, is what it's saying here. Can you believe that? Nobody teaches this stuff in the churches. If you've been called by God, you better pony up now and get going. It's time to crank this thing up. Right now, I'm just coasting. I'm young. Yeah, most people that are young waste their life. Is there any chance somebody who's young in here will not waste their life? Could we get 1 out of 10, 1 out of 100? That would be great if we could get that many. You've been called by God. You have a work to do, and you better do it, or you will not hear the trumpet sound, and you will miss your call home like you missed your call here. To escape what? Hell on earth. What's the story on mega churches? That movie I watched was a farce. They will be packed on Sunday morning, the Sunday after the rapture. Most of the Christians will be at the megachurch Sunday morning after the rapture. How do you know that? Revelation 3, the megachurch chapter. The megachurch chapter is in chapter 3. It was this church, Laodicea. And it says, I know your works, and I know you're not what? Cold. Cold's great. See? Streamers here in Phoenix. This isn't the hottest city in the United States, but boy, I tell you what, it's right. You know, it's a few stone throws from the hottest one. I think the hottest one is Laughlin. What is it? Death Valley. Strike that. I think it's Death Valley. Death Valley's got us beat. Then you got Parker. Anybody here from Parker that can still breathe? Nobody? Then you got Laughlin. Then you got Lake Havasu. Then you got El Centro, California. Oh, boy. Then you got, I don't know, come a little ways further. We get, Tupac. Oh. Yuma. Oh, gosh. Yuma. Oh, I know nobody's here from Yuma. And you got Phoenix, so we're all kind of clustered right there in one of the hottest cities, the hottest group of cities on the planet. It's hotter in Death Valley than it is in Saudi Arabia. And when you get something cold to drink here in the summer, man, it is fantastic. You ever go into the Walmart of convenience stores, QT? You ever been in there? It's hog heaven in there. You walk in there, you think you're, is this a section of glory? They have a rack of things to drink that long to clear down there. It is so beautiful. You're taking your cell phone out and take pictures of it. But when it's 110, 20 here, that is, oh, cold is fantastic. Hot, oh, it's so beautiful. If you live in a cold climate or on a cold day or here, sometimes at nights here, it gets a little cool, not cold. Beautiful, but Jesus said, I wish you were cold. Cold is good. I wish you were hot. Hot is good, but because you are in between, you're lukewarm on what I called you to do, what you're supposed to be doing, I am going to emeo, it's not the Greek word, petuo. What does petuo mean in Greek? Spit at you. I do that all the time, and my wife can't stand it. You know what it is? That's a man thing. Yeah, it's not right. There's no way to justify it. It's a male thing. You're just, if something's clogging up or something, I don't think anything of it. I take a big old suck, and then I down it. It goes up, then it brings it down. See, it's a motion, it takes skill, it's an athletic event. And then you, poof, you blow that sucker out, and you don't think anything of it, because males are doing it. Males are fine with it. Males don't have, if you're in a group of males, they'll all spit in the gun. Nobody even looks. They just, oh yeah, no problem at all. Women, no. You'll rarely see a woman up, down and in, and poof, that rarely happens. That is petuo. What is emeo in Greek? Vomit. That's the word in this verse. It is not. It is. What is that? What is that symbolizing there? You're already a Christian. You're already in. You're already saved. You're already way inside the body. I'm just blowing spit out of here. Vomiting comes from here, deeper in. Is that making any sense? He says, I'm going to vomit. My mouth, Jesus said. By the way, that's the only time that Greek word, emeo, is used anywhere in the New Testament. It's only used one time. That's odd, isn't it? Maybe it isn't. I thought it was odd. Revelation 3. Mega churches frequently say, I am rich. I've got a lot of stuff. I got all kinds of things. We've got this beautiful building. We got all these great pews. We got this fantastic video audio system. We got all this, these bands, all these singers, professional singers, great singers. We've got all of this. Plus, we got a giant parking lot. Plus, we got this other center. We got this other building. And we got the chow hall. And we got this net. We are set. But Jesus said, looks are deceiving. Okay, God looks on the inward parts. Man looks on the outward part. And God is looking on the inward part of these churches that are going to miss the rapture, the mega churches. And guess what? They are miserable, poor, blind. Oh, God, wretched. He's talking about churches, not whorehouses, not brothels, not slave auction. These are churches he's talking about. What should these people be doing? They should be buying gold, but what kind of gold? Here's the tough part. Goes back to our sacrifices for God. For the gold that's burned. Man, there isn't any way you can be successful as a minister or believer if you don't go through trials. Bad things are going to happen to you. Like what? Mesh! Things are going to happen that you weren't expecting, you weren't planning. Okay? I didn't go in to see squatty little Dr. Lipton, half my age. Doc, how you doing? You like tea? Good. Hey, give me some of that rotten recall mesh and shove her up in here, will you, baby? High five. I didn't do that. Okay? I thought it was going to go smooth. I thought when I was over, that was the end of it. No more problems. Hello? Is this thing's not even on, is it? You are going to have to be gold, what? Burned. Shoot. Is anybody reading this like I am? I counsel you. I'm advising you, he says. Buy gold from me. What kind of gold? There's all kinds of different gold. Correct? Yes. Go, even in gold coins. There's a rack of gold coins you can buy. Different ones. This one is what? Oh, man. Burned gold, symbolizing you going through some trials you overcame. Bad things happened to you. You got through it. You trusted. You learned. You failed. You grew. You learned from your failure, you got back up, you went down, you stood back up, you crawled back, you fought back, you did whatever you had to do. Hello? And you got that stuff got burned off, and now you went from here to here. Spiritually. Burned. White clothing, what's that representing? Purity, holiness? Purity and holiness. Are we all pure and holy? No, but it's a process. Okay, you have to go through a process of, you know, like fishermen whittle on the bank. They just whittle little pieces off the thing. You're not going to get saved on Monday and be holy Friday. That's not going to happen. Much of holier than thou's here tonight. It takes time to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, to study yourself approved unto God, right? So what do? You make your mistakes, you don't get hard on yourself, you don't condemn yourself, you don't drag yourself into the pit. You understand we all go through it. Everybody fails. Nobody does everything right. Okay? You don't turn on yourself and hate yourself. Come on. You learn from that and then you go to the next one. See? That's what God wants you to do. It really hurts him and bothers him when you look at yourself and, hey, I'm the biggest piece of crap that ever walked the face. No. Heck no. Trust me. Whoever said that, I'm with you. I'm as big a piece of crap as you are. Everybody has that. Everybody struggles with stuff. Okay? God's not standing over you with a hammer ready to mash your faith in. He wants to help you and he's ready to go. Shame, sinful shame, what you're doing, right? Revelation 3, as many as I love, I rebuke. Now this phrase is shocking. It doesn't say agape in that verse. Did you notice that? Right? What's he talking about here? People that he gives them an assignment and they do it and he's fond of it. Hey, I can give this gal here something and she will get to work on it. I like that. He didn't say he didn't love her. He's talking about being fond of or liking. I do what? Elenko. I convict. Conviction comes from the Holy Spirit. Condemnation comes from Satan. He always brings up your past and throws it in your face because he's trying to condemn you. Okay? The Holy Spirit gives you conviction over something you did, and that comes from love. It is never condemnation. He never condemns you. Did you hear me? Did you hear me? He never condemns you. Did you hear me? Never. That's with an M. The devil always, yeah, always, 100%, will condemn you. He'll run you to the ground full bore. I convict them. That comes out of love. As many as I like and am fond of who are doing my work, I convict them. And I pay duo. I discipline them. I train them. See? Right? So, although in my mind, this doesn't look like much training here. This is the school I want to get out of, the mesh thing. I'm ready to graduate. Things happen, and you learn, you fail, you get up, you work your way through it. That's how you do it. It's called being a human being. Anybody here not human tonight? Any Stepford wives here? Okay, androids, cyborgs, nothing? Okay. So that means everybody here is a human being, so that means you know what I'm talking about. These things happen, and it's training, it's disciplining, it's love, it's all out of love, see? Hey, Andre, what's his name, Peterson, the running back? What's his name? Adrian Peterson. When he's a kid, see, his dad would take a switch to him when he was little, preschool. What'd you do that was wrong? His dad got angry and he'd whip him, whack, and he'd cut him and bruise him and beat him. Well, that's all he knew. So when he got older and became a pro athlete and a superstar, which is what he is, superstars have kids all over the country. You know, they got kids in like in every port, as the sailors say. And when they go to town, from this town to that town, they got a stack of numbers, phone numbers, business cards from women that high in every box. Okay, groupies. These women follow these pro athletes around, and to them, having a kid, it's a lottery hit. See? So you have you chase a superstar athlete around, you get pregnant, you just hit the human lottery. Okay? Child, what do we call it? Child support. Okay? Child support is income based. So Adrian Peters is earning $40 million. Okay? That's not a guy you meet at the bar that just left the counter down here at McDonald's, happened to drop in. No. This is a hit. And so these women chase these athletes and do whatever they can to get pregnant. The trouble is figuring out which kid's yours, you know, that's a major sorting process because they sleep with two, three different, four women a night or on a weekend, half a dozen, and they were also chasing other athletes. So you've had two, the women have two and three different sex partners. The guys had six or seven women, so there's kind of a lottery spin there. You ever watch the lottery? It's kind of like that. 22, only they pull out your name. This is Bob. So then we need what? DNA testing. But anyway, what was the point I was making on that? Oh, whipping the son. So they ran through his DNA, finally figured out, hey, this kid's yours. What? Incredible, amazing. So he's in line now with all the other kids around the country. And he doesn't know any better. So he happens to be with that girlfriend with this kid, and this kid gets out of line, and he does what his dad did to him. See? Generational curses. They come right down. The same spirits your parents had hit you, they're going to hit your kids. Okay? So he's whipping his kid, and he's bleeding and everything. Well, over the years, of course, they've changed the rules on discipline now. You can't discipline kids like that anymore. That's against the law. It's a felony. And you're going to go to jail. Not really, literally. You're going. So what you got to do is replace it with the timeouts. Timeouts really work. Whoa. And so what God's telling you here is, I can't just give you a timeout, okay? And the Holy Ghost is not going to beat you to your bruised and bleeding, okay? But he is going to allow you to face something that is going to require more than a timeout and less than a bloody beating. And it's all designed to help you learn. Learning. Short case. Years ago, I was mentoring a young kid, and he had severe problems with lust. And we struggled with it with this kid for years. He's in his mid-20s. He had lust problems that were like off the hook. Well, guess what happened? One day he fooled around with a gal, and she filed a false claim against him. He got arrested. Wow, that was what we call in the secular field a wake-up call. And it was the best thing that ever happened to us. Seriously, it was the best thing that ever happened to us. He changed from that day forward. He changed. He repented. He improved. It was wonderful. But sometimes some of us, could be me, have to have a bigger shot to change than somebody else. So the Holy Ghost never allows you to be tempted above that you are able, but he will with the temptation always make a way for you to escape that you may be able to bear. And he takes each person separately, each person individually. So the discipline and training that he would give you is not what you would get. And what you got is not what she would get. Am I right? It's not a blanket thing. It's individual love. Okay? So do what? Be zealous, zelao, be passionately, eagerly changing. See? Eagerly change it. So you can go in the rapture. To him that overcomes, nikao, who is becomes a conqueror, I will grant to sit with me in my throne. Who's he talking to here? Christians. Revelation 3. megachurch Christians. Christians. Translation, you must follow my pattern as I also overcame. You overcome, you sit with me. I overcame, I sit with him. Same system. Luke chapter 12, let your loins be girded and lights burning. What's that mean? You know, be alert, be awake, be ready to go. Let's rumble on this one. You, like men, wait for their Lord when he turns from the wedding. So when he knocks, you may come and open immediately. Translation, in that movie with Nicolas Cage, after the rapture hit, they landed this plane, kind of miraculously, and it was too late. They got off the plane, he repented. He was stuck there. There was no way. So when he knocks, you gotta, be ready to go at that moment. Again, he's talking to Christians. You're blessed if you what? You were watching. You get to go to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Translation. Hey, you're going to go in the rapture. You'll hear the trumpet and bang, you go. And it doesn't matter when he comes. If you're always watching, it doesn't matter what watch he comes in. You're ready in each watch. Luke 12. Guess what would happen if you knew he was coming? Yeah, you would have been ready just at that moment. You may not be ready before that, but hey, we know I've got to change by that date and I've got to be ready to go. That's not how it works. We walk by faith, not by sight. You're not going to get a previous word from somebody, 12 o'clock tomorrow's it. Oh, now I got to get ready. No, it doesn't work like that. Too late. Be ready, because it could happen at a time when you don't think it's going to happen. Warnings. Be careful. Be ready. Yeah. I spent years here at the House of Healing trying to help people to stop coasting through their Christian life, which is systemic in America. There's so many Christians who are coasters. You see, I do this and that and that and that, and that's it. I'm just coasting. Wow. Yeah, that makes you miss the rapture. Coasting. It says, Peter said, Lord, Luke chapter 12, are you telling this parable to us or everybody? And Jesus answers him, the faithful and wise steward, this is a born-again Christian, whom the Lord will make ruler over his household, Jesus, you ruling during the during the millennium. When does he give him his portion in due season? Blessed is that serpent when his Lord finds him doing it. Finds him doing it. You've been called. You've been called. You, sir, have been called by God. To do what? It's none of my business. That's between you and God. You've been called to do something. You've been called. And you are to be diligently doing that. If you're not, guess what happens? The trumpet sounds and you miss it. You were too busy worrying about your mesh, your sickness, your cancer, your food, your kids, your retirement, your job. You got all these burdens on your life, and boom, that thing hits and you miss it. If you don't miss it, and you get to be what? You get to rule in the millennium. Fantastic. But if the servant says in his heart, no, he's not coming, he's not going to be here, guess what happens? Oops. You start eating, you start drinking, you're getting drunk, you start doing all these other things, you're going to be in trouble. But here's something fascinating. Here's something fascinating about human free will and knowledge. This is really interesting. Luke chapter 12, Jesus explains that the behavior is not the determining factor. Okay? Isn't that amazing? The servant which knew better, so to speak, and didn't do anything, shall be... more disciplined. The one that was ignorant, who did the same thing, faces something different. This verse is never read in church, and here's why. We got so many false prophets running around the church these days, and what they do is they try to puff themselves up by walking up to people and saying, God gave me a word for you. And the people, Christians in America anyway, not all over the world, they're so lazy. They never get words on their own from God. They don't read the Bible themselves. They always want somebody else to spoon feed them, like they're spiritual infants. Give me a word. You better stop doing that. You know why? The more you know, the more you're responsible for. What was that? I'm never going to ask for a word again. You better stop it. You keep running around to all these spiritual quacks, getting words from God, and the more words you get from God, the more you're responsible for. I never looked at it that way. Well, you shoulda. It says it right here. Translation, ignorance is a factor in how God disciplines his children. That's one of the negative drawbacks of coming here. I see some people caught on. If you come here, you're going to get the text shoved in your face without a filter. Now, some people like that. They want to hear the cold stone truth. The problem with that is if you get the cold stone truth shoved in your face, you are then responsible for that truth. That's why Jesus said one time that people that are teachers of the word are held at a higher standard. Say, well, is there a difference between listening to me and Joel Osteen? Now, yeah, there's a difference. He looks better than I do, but he doesn't have the great outfits. But Joel is not going to talk to you like I will. Okay? Okay. Why? A, he needs donors. B, he wants to be liked. C, got big bills. D, I'm not going to say it. My job is to filter away. Boom. That's what it says. And by coming here, you are now responsible for what I told you based on that. Not my opinions, but that, based on that. Disagreeing with my opinions is fine. I'm just a person. this is not just a person. If you're ignorant, you're treated differently than if you know a lot. Like this preacher here, 4 years ago, you would have been handled by God differently than you would be handled now, because of the vast amount of knowledge you picked up in 4 years from various sources. Correct?
Yeah.
So when you know more, you owe more. Hello. That's how it works. I know people that have been in this service, this one right here, for years, and sit there and do nothing about it. Nothing. They just look at me. Giggle once in a while. It's like, you know, it's, I mean, the humor's there. So is the mesh. They just sit there, doing nothing. Now, on Judgment Day, that person that comes here and sits has other things to answer for than that guy down there with a sign on the corner saying, "I'll work for food." They don't say that anymore, do they? Whatever it says. Is this making sense? What you know is important. To whom much is given, much is now required. So what's required of you now is different than it was 4 years ago. Required of who? Not me. I'm just a person like you. We're friends. This is God talking to you. It has nothing to do with me. How'd that one go? That was exhausting, wasn't it? It was tough. Okay, we're almost done here. And I was wrong. It wasn't going to get done early. Christians and ministers can have spirits. Oh, this is a quick section to go through. We went over these already. These are all of his lies. We don't need to go through that. And these are other lies. You've already heard all of these. And about hell and so on. I don't think we need to spend any time on that. So let's not do that. Infected Christians. Let's take a couple of examples. Who's that guy? Who's this guy? Marcus Lamb. What was had an affair. And who's that guy? Todd Bentley. Good people, good men of God. Who's that guy? The guy in Atlanta. What? Come on. Long. Who's that?
Baker.
Baker. Run. Adultery. You know, the usual stuff. Who's that? Sorry. Who's that? Pat. All good people. Good men of God. All of them. But who's that? Laredon. Who's that guy? Clement. Prophet. Again, all these people, good Christians, good men of God, great gifting, but didn't finish their deliverance. And that's the most important thing. A lot of people will start their deliverance, but they never finish the darn thing. And then they go into the ministry because they feel better, their anointing's gone up, they understand more, they've been more healed, and so on. They go into the ministry and then they... And then the devil goes, "Hey, I got plan B for you since you went into the ministry and didn't finish your deliverance. So now I got this one for you." And bang, they get hit. Now I'm telling you, people with these kind of intelligence and gifts and experience can get caught. Anybody can get caught. Anybody, any minister can get caught if they let their guard down with the devil. All of us, me, everybody. You can get caught. You are not watching and you're not diligent. Did you know the Bible doesn't say Christians cannot have demons? Yeah, you knew that. You know what Diamond Needs of Mine is? 1 Timothy 3, we've went over these before, explaining that Christians can be infected or infested with spirits and judged by Satan here. They can fall into the reproach and the snare of the devil. These are bishops, church leaders, and episcopacy is a church leader, not a new convert, remember? And 2 Timothy 2, I'm going to skip this verse too. We went over this many times. A servant of the Lord must be gentle and so on. And the reason for that is what? So people can, same Greek word, pagis, trap. The devil is always setting a trap for us. He's smarter than we are, and that's why he gets away with it. He sets traps. And we fall into some of them. And sometimes Christians fall so deep, they can be what? Taken captive by Satan. Have you ever met a born-again Christian who went massively the other direction? Anybody here in this section? Do you ever meet a Christian that was super backslider? I mean, went back into filthy, worse, almost worse than before. They used to commit adultery now, and now they're swinging or something. Anybody here? Nobody? Juan, you? You ever met a Christian that went the other direction, huge? Juan? Come over here. Nobody? Happens once in a while. And what happens there? They're taken alive. The devil takes them alive. Why? Again, we already read the scriptures. The more you know, the more knowledge you have, the more you're responsible for them. So a backslider is in bad shape. Why? They know more than a new convert that backslides. Here's a textbook, demon-affected Christian, Acts chapter 8. This is Simon the sorcerer. He believes, pistuo. He is baptized, and he follows Peter around. Standard Christian behavior. Watching the miracles. Acts chapter 8. Peter says to a born-again Christian these words, and it gives you an idea of how frightening sin is for Christians. It is scary for Christians to keep on sinning when they know better. Frightening. This guy was a new convert. None of us ever talked to a new convert like this. He did. Your heart's not right with God. Man, that's a blast for a new guy. You need to do what? Metanoeo. Repent. Go back the other direction. Turn around and go that away. So the thoughts in your heart may be forgiven you. Wow. And he says, you have bitterness in your soul. Kole, bile. And pikrian, poison. Wow. And iniquity in your soul. He's talking to a born-again Christian. So, what's he saying here? Christians can have these things in their heart, and it's a process of removing it. Okay? So Peter's telling the guy, listen, don't go commit suicide. Just repent. So here's a really bad case, apparently. And he says, repent and let's change. So if you have these things in your heart, you're struggling. God's not telling you to go shoot yourself. He's telling you to repent. Let's go. Turn around and go back this way, and I'll be with you, and I'll help you through this thing. We'll whittle it down. We'll overcome these valleys. We'll work this thing out together, and we'll come out on the other side as an overcomer, so you will hear the trumpet when it sounds. Right? So if this guy here is told to repent, not shoot himself, that means that God wanted to keep Simon. He probably ended up some great faith, you know, be my guess. I don't know that. That's just my opinion. And maybe I'm wrong. Maybe he did go shoot himself. But I think he repented. That's my view on it. I think he became some great faith healer or something. You know why? Because Peter didn't give up on him. He told him the truth without a filter. He didn't Joel Osteen the guy. He just blunted it out there. Boom, this is what you are.
What scripture was that again?
This is Acts chapter 8. That's one of the greatest chapters in the book of Acts. Have you ever read Acts chapter? You ought to read it once a month. It's a carnival practically. It's everything going on in chapter 8. It's unreal. Wow. It is fantastic reading. Great reading. Repent, he said. Don't kill yourself. Change. Go back the other way. See? Look, you're a born-again Christian. God loves you, but you've got some bitterness against some people in your heart. You got a little iniquity in there, in your soul. Hello? He's telling, this is what he's telling. I'm just paraphrasing Peter. But, hey, you got some bondages in there. But what I want you to do is repent. Let's work through this thing. Keep going. I'm with you. And you're going to, down the road here, you're going to be an overcomer. And you're going to keep winning. You're going to be a winner. Period. It's guaranteed with the Holy Ghost. If you don't quit, you're guaranteed to win. The quitters are the ones that are not guaranteed to win it. They lose. But if you screw up, foul up, cluck it up, it doesn't matter. Okay, if you don't quit. Could I get that truth through your soul right now? Would you just receive that one thing from me tonight? If you don't quit and give up, things are not good. You say, I failed, I did this and that. Now, I know you did. I do it too. Everybody does it. Everybody fails. But if you don't quit and you won't give up, you will win. That's a fact. That's a fact. Now, it's going to be tough. You know, there are some hard days. See? There's days when you're totally exhausted and you don't feel like going on. You had them days. So have you. You had them days. You felt like, hey, I wish I was gone. Right? Yeah. This guy here had several of them. Okay? What's that mean? It means he hasn't quit. He's sitting right there. Okay, that means he hasn't quit. What do I know from that guy? He's eventually going to win. Because if Simon the Sorcerer was told, keep going, dude. Man, then we can all be told that. Just keep going, okay? Put that behind you. And let's go to the next one. Right, sir? Put it behind you and let's go. Put that shame and guilt back. Failure, the loss, the stupidity, the ignorance, the asininity, the moronity. Yeah, you've done it all. Don't raise your hand. Yeah, I know what you did. Doesn't matter. Just keep going. Don't quit. Don't give up. Don't stop. It's not good. Okay, but don't quit. Yeah, this sucks. Yeah, it does. Don't give up. All right, and then James 3 talks about a Christian's receiving, I'm going to skip through here, demonic wisdom. Daimoniotis is a Greek word. It means demonic. Some Christians can receive demonic wisdom. That's very prevalent in the new charismatic movement with the Kundalini. Wow, it's just awful. They get visions and signs and wonders that are straight from familiar spirits. I mean, it's scary. And it's powerful. Powerful. That's what it is. Demonic wisdom. Okay? Luke 11, Jesus said, you can have light and darkness in you at the same time. What it really means is, scotus shady. You can be a shady Christian. You ever met one of those? Shady Christians? Yeah. They're usually selling investments at your church. You ever ran into one of those guys? Oh, fright night. Put your hands up like that. Run. They've got an investment for you. It's too good to be true. It's too good to be true. No part dark. And that's the goal of the Holy Spirit. He wants to take all of us to a spot where we don't have any darkness anymore. Okay? And that was Simon. He still had some darkness. But he was told to keep going. You are told by God, this is a word from God, don't give up, don't stop, keep going. Thus saith the Lord. I just gave you a word. Satisfied with that word? You don't need to go to a Kundalini, get another one. Don't give up. Keep going. Okay, don't stop. Don't give up. Keep going. And soon you will have no part dark. You will win. You're going to get this crap out of there. We're all going to cleanse it out, and it's going to work great. Okay, let me skip that verse and
This is Jesus with spirit of infirmity. I'm going to skip that one. Oh, you hypocrites. Okay, let's go to the last one. Okay, here we go. We're at the last one now. Your time's running out. This is a short section. We will all be dead soon, okay? Everybody in this section is going to be dead soon. I see five or six real soon. I got everybody in this section here dead soon. Whoa, I see seven or eight real soon. This one, real dead soon. I don't see anybody there real soon. Now, here's what we've got. 2.4 million people die in this country every year. You will soon be one of them. 804 people die per 100,000 people. There's 2 million people living in where? Inside the city limits of Phoenix, Arizona. We're the fifth or sixth largest city. We're the fifth or sixth largest city. Fifth largest city. We're the fifth largest city in the United States. Phoenix now. And that's 2 million. You do the math. Your life expectancy is about 78 years. Okay? And 7 deaths per 100,000 live births. 7 people die when they're born per 100. Okay? What's the leading cause of death? The devil gives people heart disease. That's number one. Cancer is number two. Stroke is number three. 4, respiratory diseases, most of these are self-induced, smoking. Accidents, 5. Alzheimer's is now number 6. I mean, this thing's spreading like wildfire. Diabetes, number 7. That's climbing like orbiting. This diabetes is moving way up the ladder fast. Flu and pneumonia, number 8. Ebola. Yeah. Ebola, hopefully that's not going to be on the list. Medical error. What was the name of that lawyer over there? Somebody had a lawyer over here. I need to get a lawyer over there. Okay. I just gave you 20 things that you can watch again on YouTube. Absolute truths, 1 through 5. 20 things I shared with you, the devil does not want anybody to know. And to him, my response is, there's the 20. And what are you going to do about it? Okay, the more you know, the more you're responsible for. You came here, some of you have seen all 20 of the, how many have seen all 20 of them? A couple of you. 1, 2. 2 people have seen all 20. Oh, they're in deep trouble. And they are responsible for incredible amounts. What is your next step? Yeah. All right. Those 20 truths are on YouTube. Questions in this section? How about that section? No questions? Good. That section? No? What's that? Nobody? Okay. Now, before you leave tonight, you'll be required, I got this from Robert, to recite all 20 of them, or you're spending the night here. So let's start in the back there, gal right there on the right. 1, 2, and 3, please. Okay, Robert, it's the last time I take his advice. We will not be having a quiz. Okay, anyway, I'm joking, but you got the 20 truths. If you keep those hardcore truths and not let somebody feed you some kind of false doctrine, you're going to be held in good stead here as you go forward to get your ministry. Amen. Now, I'm planning on being here next Friday, depending on your prayer. Anybody collect mesh, by the way? Nobody in any of those sections. All right, fine. Got that covered. All right. Shall we pray? Lord, Father, all of us have to go through disciplining and trials and temptations and everything. I got my mesh thing, and all this other stuff, and other people have, they have other stuff. I pray for each and every one of them that has problems like I do, like mesh or other things. I pray that you will bless them and use them for your glory. I pray you'll just take those little trials, those little fights, those little battles, and I pray that you will just use those fights and battles as a learning tool, a training tool for them to gain more knowledge, more patience, more experience, more endurance, just like Peter taught us. And so they will be able to stick it to the devil the next time he comes a-calling. I want you to give them this knowledge and this experience and this patience. Patience with people, patience with themselves, patience with you. So they can just stick it to the devil the next time he comes calling. He will come calling, Lord. I know he will. But you'll be waiting there ready. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You endured the 20 absolute truths. And that's an absolute truth. It's the 21st. So we are going to take a 5-minute break. If you need some private prayer tonight, you come right down to the front here. And we will be down here to pray for you. Okay? I love you. Thank you for your donations. The green donation bucket's in the back. I hope to see you next week. Thanks for your prayers. Monday morning, 7 o'clock, you will be enjoying a latte somewhere. I will be out. I will be out more than I normally am. God bless you. This will be a different kind of out. Thanks. Thanks for chipping that in. That's payback for that earlier comment. Amen. You are dismissed until we... Streamers, good evening. Please don't... turn off your computer. We want to pray for you tonight. If somebody's here that has a similar illness that you have, that's a sign from the good Lord that you're to receive your healing along with them. If you have the same condition or something of that nature, tonight you're to be healed. If you see somebody down here, hey, you know what? They have a similar condition to me. That's the good Lord talking to me, telling me that tonight's my night to be healed. Tonight's my night to receive. All right, tonight, if you have a physical illness, I want you to take a couple seconds, and I'll lead you through the prayer. If you have a physical illness of some kind, you've been prayed for before, and you haven't been healed. Okay, that means that there's something's blocking that healing. Something's blocking the healing. Okay, and we need to figure out what that is. Okay? Usually, it's what Peter said to Simon the sorcerer. Normally, it's some kind of deep-seated bitterness or unforgiveness that you have toward usually A, yourself, or usually B, someone else. Usually someone else who hurt you sometime in the past and treated you or disrespected you or dishonored you or hurt you somehow emotionally. And there is still some negative feelings on your part about that person or about yourself. Okay, now if you don't repent of those things and you don't release them, we're not going to be able to most probably see you healed tonight. Right? That's something that has to be done first. The Bible's a stickler on that about holding bad feelings toward yourself or somebody else. Okay? There just isn't any way to get around it. I wish there was, but there isn't. It's the Word of God. If you got bad feelings about yourself or somebody else, that is just going to kill us. It's going to hurt us really bad. Okay? So I'm going to be leading you in the prayer, streamers, on how to repent of that. And God will just lift that pain out of your soul tonight. And He will heal you tonight. And He will give you the grace and the mercy to release that other person. It's usually a family member. It's usually a spouse. It's usually a spouse or a family member. Usually. You got bad feelings about. It's also usually somebody who you trusted, a business partner, a friend, an other relative, something like that, who betrayed you. Generally speaking, those are the usual suspects. Number two, if you need to be delivered tonight or healed, and you are not willing to repent or make major changes in your life, we're going to have a terrible time tonight seeing you delivered from the bondage of the devil. If you've got some things that you just are not willing to give up or you won't repent of, we're going to have a terrible time here. Terrible. Terrible time. Seeing you healed or delivered. You must be willing to forgive and release the ought you have for others and yourself. Does that make sense? Does that make any sense? All right. Thirdly, streamers, don't think we've left here. We turn the lights out to give people visual privacy so they can pray in private, because some people feel self-conscious about other people looking at them while they're praying. So we just turn the lights off to give you a little visual privacy. That's all we're doing. We're not trying to spook you or sneak up on you or anything of that nature. Okay? Just trying to get you to feel comfortable here and relax. Okay? You can feel comfortable here and relax. This is a very, very unusual place for ministry. I'm the manager of the place, and I'm not even a preacher. I'm actually a counselor by trade. I take a very relaxed approach to everything. You can relax here. Nobody here is going to condemn you for anything you've ever done, not in a million years, because I remember the things I did, and I don't want to be held accountable for my sins, and I'm not going to hold anybody else accountable. That's between you and the good Lord. So it's not my job under any circumstances to condemn you or pronounce a sentence upon you. Okay? This is a very forgiving facility here at the House of Healing. Very forgiving facility. No one comes in here, no matter what sin they've committed, and gets condemned by anybody here. That's not going to happen. If it does happen occasionally, but when I find out about it, I get rid of the people that do it. We don't have any space here for that. And I just boot them out the door. Boom, you're gone. And the people that are left, this is a love situation. Love and care, not condemning. Now, I will have to get a little rough with a couple of you. Yeah, but I'm encouraging you to pray harder. That's all I'm doing. I sound like I'm stern, or somebody else may sound a little stern. It's not personal. We're just trying to get you to reach out further, reach out harder, because we know the Holy Ghost is standing right there. And if you'll open your heart, repent of your sins, and humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, He will exalt you in due time. And that time is tonight. Amen. All right, now on my left side here, if you need a physical healing, just come up and stand over here on my left in front of Preacher Steve here. Just stand right over there by that fan there. On my left, that would be your right. You need to be physically healed. Or the ministry team, come forward now. There you go. Stand over here on your right. If you're in some kind of emotional bondage, you got emotional pain or something, you come up here and stand on my right. That would be your left. Come up here and stand on my right. If you're emotionally ill, have any emotional problems, if you have any demonic problems, you're being stalked by spirits, your house is haunted, your body's haunted, you come over here and stand on my right. Just have a seat in this front row right here. We'll do you next. Have a seat there. Anybody here need to have a spiritual bondage? Sit right here in the front row. We'll be right with you. Okay, we'll be right here. Anybody else? Anybody else need a physical touch tonight? Over here. Oh, you guys can go over there. I'll stay here. What'd she say?
She can't see.
Can't see? Here, can you bring her up? Yeah, bring her up and bring her over here. Thank you, sweet Jesus. Okay, she needs prayer. Have her on the left. My left, your right. Yeah, have her right over here. There you go. Good. There you go. All right, now streamers, I want you to listen to this. What do you need from the Lord, honey?
To help me see and...
You have vision problems?
Yes.
Okay. What do you need, sweetheart?
My intestinal area is inflamed.
Oh, inflamed? Okay. Yep. How long you had that inflamed intestine?
Small intestine.
How long?
Well, after I had a colonoscopy, they found it.
What
about
was
that? A month ago.
About a month ago.
Yeah.
Then what was going on before that?
I didn't even have any symptoms.
Oh, you didn't?
No.
Okay.
I really don't.
All right.
Pain.
Pain where?
Everywhere. My knees.
What was that?
My knees and my left hip.
Okay.
Right knee, left hip.
Left hip. Now, you don't have any mesh.
No, I'm letting you have all of
it. I got left pain in my left hip. That's mesh related. Yeah,
I'm getting that reflex back.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
Okay.
The awake girl last night.
Oh, okay. You go stand on that side then. Over there. Yes, sir? What's your name, sir?
My name is Sasuke.
Is your wife?
Yes.
What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you, dear?
Oh, okay. Diabetes, blindness, and this big old growth right here.
Diabetes?
Yes.
Okay. Now, you come on over on this side, then. I'll take you over here first, all right? There, turn around there if you want. This way. There we go. Okay. Streamers, did you hear those illnesses?
What we got here?
A stroke.
What's that?
I had a stroke in May.
You had a stroke?
Yeah, and they're saying I have a hyperthyroid.
Now, you need prayer?
Oh, I think my hormones is under the balancing.
Balancing of hormones?
Yeah.
Okay,
you're
on that side.
Okay.
Yeah, you stay here. Okay, you had a stroke, and what was the other one?
Hyperthyroidism.
Okay.
My calcium is not too high.
All right. The streamers, did you hear those illnesses? Now, if you have anything similar to that, you just stand right there in front of your computer. Right now, we're going to go to prayer. I want each one of you pray with me. Right now, in the name of Jesus, Father, I'm asking you right now to forgive me for any negative feelings I have about myself, about my childhood, about my parents, about my spouse, about my marriage, about my life. Lord Jesus, asking you to forgive me for any wounds I carried forward from my childhood. I'm asking you to forgive me right now and have mercy on my soul. Go back into my past, dear Lord, and find every wound in my soul right now in the name of Jesus. Every heartache and every sorrow I ever faced, I release it to you now, right now, dear Jesus. I open my heart right now for every person I lost my temper with, every person I cursed out, every person I yelled at, every time I cursed myself and said negative things about me every time I saw myself as second rate, second best. Every time I disputed and angered and yelled at one of my family members, and especially my parents. Oh God, I'm asking you right now in the name of Jesus to forgive me for what I did. I just lift it up to you right now, Lord. I release it to you right now, sweet Jesus. I give it to you, Lord, handing it to you right now. I'm going to talk to the ladies just for a minute. Lord Jesus, I release from my soul every ugly man that ever touched my body when I was younger. Every man I ever foolishly dated who was infected with spirits and abused me and criticized me and said negative things about me. Every boyfriend, every fiance, every ex-spouse, even my current spouse. In the name of Jesus, I release this from my soul tonight in the name of the Lord. And I ask you to forgive me, Father, for holding these bad feelings about these men. And I release them tonight in the name of Jesus. I release them tonight in the name of Jesus. Ladies, I'm going to pray for you again. Every woman in this room who's got a big mouth, who runs their mouth and says negative things and criticizes other people and says rotten stuff and comes out of their mouth like vomit. Every woman streaming right now who has a problem, there it is right there. That wound is right there. Let it go. Come out right now in the name of Jesus. Every woman with a big mouth, critical, negative, abusive, foolish, argumentative, pushy. Every woman streaming right now in the name of Jesus, I ask you, Lord, to release this wound from my soul and from my childhood right now in the name of Jesus. Every pain from my mother or father, I release it right now. There it is. Take a big breath. Every pain from my parents, I just release it right now in the name of Jesus. All right, our people are going to start praying for you right now. Just briefly tell them what's wrong with you. The Holy Spirit's going to heal you just in a few seconds. Ready? Thank you, Jesus. I release both my parents. I release all my brothers and sisters. They were all so ugly to me. They were all so cruel to me. They were so mean to me, and I forgive them, and I release them right now. Every negative, nagging word I ever spoke out of my mouth, I repent of it right this second in the name of the Lord. Every time I said something bad about me, my parents, my husband, my brother, every single one of them, I release it right now in the name of Jesus Christ so I can be healed. I release all of it in the name of the Lord now. Come out, every bit of it. Every bit of it. Every bit of it. Every bit of stress I internalize, I let go in the name of Jesus. Every ounce of stress, go in Jesus' holy name. There they come. Go in Jesus' holy name. Every ounce of stress and pressure I internalize in my body, I release it right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I command every man who ever touched my body to come out of my body right now in the name of Jesus. I command every act of adultery to be renounced and rejected right now in Jesus' mighty name. Right at this moment, I release the abuse of my childhood. And I let it go right now. I release at this moment worrying about my children, myself, and my parents. I cast out every ounce of doubt and unbelief in my soul right now in the name of Jesus. I cast it out right now in the name of Jesus, and I command it to go. Come on now, just say that. In the name of Jesus, I command it to go. Say that. In the name of Jesus, I command it to go. I release my children now, finally, and I repent of worrying over them all the time, and I repent of having negative thoughts, and I repent of taking in wounds. I repent of ugly men. I repent right now of listening to voices in my head, and I command them to come out in the name of Jesus Christ. Get out of my body right now in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Come out in the name of the Lord. Satan, you should hold in the name of Jesus Christ. I command all my husband's spirits to leave me. And I release my husband into your hands, Lord. I let him go right at this second. I let him go right now. Every childhood wound, every abuse comes out right now in Jesus' mighty name. Every time I open my mouth and said something I shouldn't, I retract it and repent of it now in the name of Jesus. And I command fear and worry to come out of my head right now. I repent of listening to demons talk in my brain. This is my brain, not theirs. My mind is turned over to the Lord, not theirs anymore. I command them to come out, and I do hate them tonight. And I receive the glorious gift of hate. I hate sin, and I hate the devil. I hate sickness. I hate bondages. I hate illnesses. I hate them, and I command them to come out of my body right now in Jesus' mighty name. Get out of my body right now. Go. Get out of my body right now. Go. I renounce doubt and unbelief in Jesus' name. Go.
All my stress from my career, all my stress from my job, it leaves me tonight in Jesus' name. It leaves me tonight in Jesus' name. Get out of my head right now. I hate you. Come out of my brain right this second. Get out of my head. I hate you right now. Come out of my head. Get out of my body right now. Satan, come out quicker. Get out of my head right now in the name of Jesus. I break this curse off of me. Come on now. Let your daughter go once and for all. Come on, let her go. Let your daughter go once and for all. Satan, come out. Come on, fight hard. Satan, I command you to come out. Get out of my body right now. Come out of my body right now in Jesus' holy name. Get out. I command this broken heart to leave my soul right now in the name of Jesus.
I command all my disappointments to come out right now. There they come. Go. Come out right now. Disappointments. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Disappointments. Disappointments with my husband. Disappointments with my wife. Come out. Disappointments with myself. I'm disappointed with myself. I repent of it right now. I repent of it right now. Being disappointed with myself. I repent of it now in the name of Jesus Christ. I bring all family curses from my parents and my grandparents. Generational sin, generational religion, generational demons. I go back in time 20 generations and command them to come out.
Put your hand right on your stomach.
20 generations, come out in Jesus' mighty name.
Every wound. Fear, come out of me right now. Say that. Fear, come out of my body right now. Now take a breath and blow. Come out right now. Go.
Satan, go.
Come on. Your daughter has to be released to the Lord. You don't have a daughter anymore. You gave her to God. Now let her go right this second. So he can break her. He hasn't healed her because you keep worrying and you're anxious about it. Let's go. Let's let her go. Come on. Let her go right now. I release my daughter in the name of Jesus Christ. I release my pain and my worry over my daughter right now. Go right now in Jesus' holy name. Satan, come out of my body quicker. Come out faster.
Satan, I hate you for stealing my mind. I hate you for putting thoughts in my head. I hate you for ruining week after week, month after month. I hate you. Now come out now.
I release my daughter right now, and I'm not playing anymore. Come on now. You've got to get rid of her. You keep taking her back, and you keep getting sucked into more pain. Go. Go right now. Everything go in Jesus' name. Every voice in my head, I hate you, and I command you. I hate you, and I command you to come out of my head.
Every voice in my mind, every voice in my head, I curse you and I command you in Jesus' mighty name. Every disappointment with my mother and father or my husband, I release right now. Every disappointment. There it comes. Every disappointment with everybody that hurt me. Every heartache, every sorrow. I release it now in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. Every sorrow. Go.
From now on, I'm leaving my career at the office. I'm letting it go and replacing it with the joy of the Spirit. And I release
this pressure and stress in my esophagus in the name of Jesus. Acid reflux, I curse you and I command you to come up out of that man of God. Come out in Jesus' holy name. Come out in the name of the Lord. Go right now. Go right now. Go right now.
Come on, sweetie. You pray harder. You break off every curse. You pray harder. Come on. Pray harder. Tell him to come out. All the ugly men, all the curses, come out now. Get out of my body right now. Say that. Go.
Say that. Get out of my body right now. Pray just like that. Pray hard, just like that. In Jesus' holy name.
Okay, raise your hand. And breathe out of your mouth. Breathe out your mouth. Lord Jesus, you see this beautiful woman standing here? She needs your help tonight. Raymond touched her. And he violated her when she was so little. He stole her innocence. He stole her virginity and he transferred a spirit into her body who is now making her sick. He's hiding in there right now. Raymond, in the name of Jesus Christ, we forgive you and we release you from her soul now, and we command you, Raymond, to come out now. Raymond, come out of her right now. Come out, Raymond. Raymond, come out of her genitals right now. You come out of her stomach right this second. The fear demon from Raymond, you come out now. Come out. You take a breath and blow her. Come right out. Come out. Keep blowing. Good. Blow. Come out of her. Spirit of fear, come out. Right now. There he comes. Here he comes. Go. Come out of her body. Come out of her stomach right now. Come out. Come out of there. Right now. Raymond, come out of there right now. I know you're there and I know you're coming out. Go. Come out of my body right now. Raymond, I release you right now and I forgive you. Raymond, I release you right now and I forgive you. I release you right now. Raymond, come out now. It's better? Okay. Close your eyes. Raymond, come out of me right now. Raymond, come out. Right now. Raymond, come out right now in the name of the Lord.
Lois.
Okay. Close
that's
your eyes.
That's disturbing to me.
Yeah, that's disturbing. Close your eyes. Okay, now breathe out of your mouth. All right. Hey, where are you going?
Oh, I...
Stand over here. Where are you going? You're not healed yet. Hold on a minute. Stay right here.
Okay.
Yeah. In the name of Jesus, heal. And raise your arms. Raise your arms. Move them around. Now you do it yourself. Move them around. Could you do that before? You're getting healed right now. Hey, she got raped when she was 4. Can you get all that out of her? Now, come on over here.
This is what disturbed me.
Now, listen. What's her name again?
What
was her name again?
Lois, my mother.
Now, close your eyes. Now, I'm just going to pray, and you breathe out your mouth, okay? Pray. All right, now I'm going to pray now. Lord, this powerful woman of God is standing here tonight, and there's something in her soul that has been in there for years and should never have been in there before. And she has negative thoughts about her mother because she sees her mother do things that she sees as wrong. And so she internalized that pain that her mother was causing other people. And she took it in here. And now it's hurting her soul and blocking her healing. And Lord, I want you to remove her mother from her soul tonight. Because her mother is your business, not hers. And we're going to trust you to heal her and touch her. Is she still alive?
Yeah.
Okay. Lord, we're going to trust you to heal her and touch her. And her daughter is going to release her tonight and repent of carrying around this wound right in there over her mother. And the way her mother treats people, she treats them negatively and she hurts them. And it bothers her daughter. And I'm asking you right now to forgive her daughter for having those negative feelings about mama. And I'm asking you to help her release her mother in the name of Jesus right now. At the count of three. What was her name again?
Lois.
Are you ready? Take a breath. Father, I agree right now to repent of carrying around negative feelings in my soul for my mother. And having critical thoughts over her. And in Jesus' name, I release her right now. I release her from my soul in the name of Jesus. Take a breath and blow. I'll release her right now from the bottom of my feet to the top of my head. For the first time in my life, I completely release my mother from my soul. Come out right now. Mother, go right now. I let my mother go right now so I can be healed. Mother, I'm sorry I had these thoughts about you. I'm sorry I said those things to you. I was trying to help you, but it was actually hurting me. I knew when I told you this and that you weren't going to listen anyway. And I release you tonight in Jesus' name. Now go. Now, don't stop doing that. But here's what I want you to do. Here's the way to draw in the Holy Ghost.
Okay.
Singing in tongues is the number one way.
Okay.
And don't wait for him to tell you that. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Satan, loose your hold. Spirit of infirmity from my children, come out. Come out. Come out of my head right now. Go. In Jesus' mighty name, you let go of the woman of God. You tortured her long enough. You had her long enough. Don't you ever speak to her again. You come out of that head right now. Shut your mouth and come out in Jesus' holy name. Shut your mouth. Stop talking to him right now and come out of that head. I release you from my brain. Stop talking to me right now in Jesus' name. Get out of my head. Stop talking to me right this second. Come out of my head. Satan, come out right now in Jesus' mighty name.
Can you pray for this lady?
Satan, you come out of her head right now in Jesus' name. Come out. Get out of her head right now. Come out of there. Come out quicker. Tell him to come out. Right now. Come out of her right now. There he comes. Tell him to come out. Tell him to come out. I release my relatives right this second. They use me like a doormat. They walk off. They take my stuff and they take my money. And I command them to come out. I release my relatives right now. I release my children. Go. Get out of my head right this second. I hate you. Come out of my head right now. I hate you. Go. Go, Satan. Go, Satan. Go now.
Go now. Go, Satan. Satan, loose your hold. Satan, loose your hold. Streamers, you go to the website, hardcorechristianity.com. You hit the button at the top, self-deliverance. Then you go to the other button, post-deliverance. You must do that 12-step program so you do not get reinfected. So you do not get reinfected. Post-deliverance in Jesus' holy name. Go to the website. Then hit the teaching button at the top. Teaching. Hit the teaching button. And then go down to the article. Satan's counterattack. After you leave here tonight, in the next 48 hours, the devil will try to attack you. 48 hours. Read that article on the teaching. Satan's counterattack. It's at the bottom of the teaching page. Read that article so you do not lose your healing or lose your deliverance. In Jesus' holy name. What's your name, sweetheart?
Anne Marie.
And what was wrong with your shoulder when you came in?
I couldn't lift it.
How's it doing now?
I mean, I couldn't lift my arm.
Move it around. Yeah. Move it more. How about like this?
Go like that. Wave like that.
Wave like that.
Yeah.
Did you have any neck limitations when you came here tonight? Anything wrong with your neck?
No.
How about your low back?
No.
Was that normal? How about your knees? It was just your shoulders? Anything else? Is it healed? Raise your hands up and move them around. Good girl. There you go. This girl just got healed of a shoulder illness of some kind. I don't know what the medical term was. Didn't ask her. But anyway, she's moving her arms around. Streamers, put your hands on your shoulders right now. Ready? One, two, three. Satan, come out now! All right, move your shoulders around. Move them up. Move them down just like she was. Move your shoulders up. Move them down just like she was. She got healed. Thank you, Jesus. Come on. Come on. Now, streamers, I want you to pray for me tonight. I'm going into surgery Monday morning. I don't want to do it. I just assumed the mesh disappear. So I'm going to pray for myself right now. And you pray with me, will you? Father, in the name of Jesus, I put my hands on this mesh the doctor shoved in there. And I release it into your hands. And I command this thing to just shrivel up and disappear. I command this mesh in my inguinal hernia on the right to shrivel up and disappear in Jesus' mighty name. Thus saith the Lord. Shrivel up. Go. Go. In Jesus' holy name. We will see you next week. May God richly bless you.